Adolf Hitler, leader of a Nazi war machine that came within inches of conquering the world before he died in his bunker in 1945. But new evidence tells another story of his escape to Argentina.
I'm Patrick Henningsen, and this is the 21st Century Wire.
History tells us that an insane Adolf Hitler committed suicide in a bunker in Berlin in 1945 with his wife, Eva. Rumors abounded about a daughter, Uschi, and a son, although there is no hard evidence for their existence. Eva Braun's brother-in-law, SS General Hermann Fegelein, was reported executed after being court-martialed in Berlin at the fall. No sunken U-boats have yet been found off the coast of Argentina. History also tells us that Martin Bormann, known as the Brown Eminence and the man who Hitler said he needed to win the war, died in Berlin trying to escape in 1945, and that his body was found in 1972 and confirmed by German government DNA analysis in 1998. History does not tell us that Adolf Hitler lived in Argentina with his wife Eva and their children. But these people, all of whose testimony is real, swear that it's true. Olga Müller and numerous other people saw him and Eva at the Hotel Vienna in Mar Chiquita and elsewhere in Cordoba province in 1946. In 2008, she was told the Gestapo are still active and had her life threatened for talking to us. Catalina Gomero spent weeks in 1948 waiting on him in two properties owned by the Eichhorn family in Cordoba, at La Falda and Pan Azucar. She would take phone calls from him until 1962, 17 years after his alleged suicide in Berlin. At 3 p.m. on the 13th of February 1962, tormented, demented, and betrayed, the most evil man of the 20th century finally died. We were lied to.
We're joined here today with investigative journalist and author of Grey Wolf, Mr. Gerrard Williams. Gerrard, thank you very much for joining us today.
My pleasure, Patrick.
Just quickly, tell us a little bit about yourself and your career.
I'm a television journalist, a former Reuters television duty editor, BBC foreign duty editor. I spent most of the late 80s and 90s on the road and early 2000s covering stories as diverse as the civil war in Yugoslavia, 2.5 years in Belgrade and in now to Bosnia, Iraq twice after the first and after the second Gulf Wars. I covered the Rwanda massacres and everything from the fall of the Soviet Union to the Mandela elections. I suppose the last big story I did was the tsunami in Sri Lanka when the whole of Southeast Asia was devastated. So I've been a television journalist and a newspaper journalist on occasion since I was 19, so 34 years.
So tell us about this story. This is incredible. This is like the Ark of the Covenant or Who Killed Kennedy. This is big in historical terms. How did this come about? And this is about Hitler escaping from the bunker to Argentina. A lot of people are going to look at this, Gerrard, and think, whoa, this is a conspiracy theory.
That's exactly how I looked at it when we started doing this. We were in, my crew and I were in Argentina doing a series of documentaries on the Children of the Disappeared, a story that's come up recently with both of the two members of dictatorship being jailed again for stealing children during the dirty war in Argentina. We were doing pieces on the economic collapse. We're doing the 25th anniversary of the Falklands conflict, or the Falklands-Malvinas conflict, to give it its proper name. And I came across this story that Adolf Hitler had escaped by submarine to Argentina. And I thought, I've never done a conspiracy theory film. I've never done a really stupid film. And after years and years and years of doing hard news, international events, death, famine all across the world, I thought that it might be a fun, interesting, lightweight subject to do. And I'd never thought about doing one before. So we started to look at it. And we started to look at the information that's available in Argentina. Various books have been written there, which don't appear elsewhere. They haven't been published overseas. There's a lot of information about the Nazis' penetration of Argentina from 1943 onwards. Again, most of this is in the Spanish language and hasn't been translated and brought overseas. And we came back to the UK, and I started to work with my military historian friend Simon Dunstan, and we started to look at it, and it was still going to be a conspiracy theory story. 14 trips later to Argentina, and trips to Berlin, and trips to America, and a lot of time in study at the Kew archives, and an amazing amount of reading and looking back at the contemporaneous reporting of what happened at the time, at the end of April 1945. Suddenly came to light, or not suddenly came to light, began to gradually come to light that the story we'd been told about Hitler killing himself in the bunker was simply a story. There was no forensic evidence to Hitler's end in the bunker. In fact, the forensic evidence that's been lauded for the last 60 years, that the Russians have parts of his skull and his jawbone, well, the skull's been DNA tested. It's that of a woman. And it's a woman much older than Eva Braun, so it can't even be her skull. When you started to put it all together, and with the eyewitnesses that we found to Hitler's presence in Argentina post-war, and since we wrote Grey Wolf, we've actually got more people coming out of the woodwork telling us stories about Hitler's presence in Argentina post-war, it became obvious that this wasn't any sort of conspiracy theory. We'd stopped laughing about it. And in fact, you know, I think we were in shock for a while that the idea that everything we had been told by these eminent historians, this story that had been propagated and told and told and told again so that it became the rock-solid historical truth, was actually rubbish. We have interviews from the time with the pilot who flew them out. We have material from the Russians when they first arrived at the bunker. They were handed six body doubles of Hitler, none of whom was Adolf Hitler. We have BBC reports from arriving at the bunker where Thomas Cadet, the Paris bureau chief pre-war, was embedded with Soviet forces when he arrived. Cadet said they found no body that could have been Hitler's. As we started to progress along it, there are places in Grey Wolf where we can't find exactly what happened in the timeline. But you find something that happened, and then along the timeline, you find the presence of Hitler in Argentina. And this isn't like Elvis sightings. None of these people have been paid any money to tell their stories to us. In fact, a number of them have actually had death threats from people or persons unknown in Argentina since they told us their story. I'm amazed that people haven't actually looked at all the evidence that we have presented in Grey Wolf, because we don't make things up. This is material that is actually reported by proper correspondents of the time, AP reporters, Reuters reporters, United Press International reporters, BBC correspondents. Stalin and Marshal Zhukov thought he'd escaped. Stalin said he'd gone to Spain or Argentina. Zhukov said he could have flown out at the last moment. There was an airfield and planes at his disposal. Well, we found that pilot. He was on trial in Warsaw in 1947 for being a member of the SS. He was brought to trial, asked who he was, and he explained who he was, Captain Peter Baumgart, and he told the trial that he had been the man who'd flown Hitler out of the Hohenzollern Dam, which is a big boulevard in Berlin, on the 30th of April 1945, and flown them into Tonda in Denmark, the former Imperial Zeppelin base in Denmark. Well, the judges in Warsaw thought he was mad, so they sent him away for psychiatric testing. Well, 6 months later, Captain Peter Baumgart was brought back, certified by three senior psychiatrists in Poland as being completely sane, and he gave the same story with more detail of exactly what had happened. Baumgart was in prison until 51 for being a member of the SS in Poland, and then he disappears. We have no more information about what happened to Baumgart afterwards. It's not just Baumgart, though. There are other witnesses to the escape from Berlin. There are all the people who'd spoke to Hitler in the bunker, who was afterwards interrogated by American and British forces. For instance, the senior Japanese diplomat, senior military diplomat, Japanese, in Berlin at the fall, who was interrogated in Tokyo later, He said he saw Hitler on the 27th, 28th, and Hitler had no suggestion that he was going to commit suicide, and he told him he was going to flee south. Well, flee south may have meant to Berchtesgaden. Flee south could have meant to Argentina. But there are so many people that he said he would escape and flee south to. I think one of the most telling things for us was that we found that the last pictures of Adolf Hitler, supposedly, of him on March the 20th, not on April the 20th, but on March the 20th, handing out medals to Hitler youth who had been responsible for tank destroying in the Battle for Berlin, with Arthur Axmann, the Hitler youth leader. Those pictures are not of Adolf Hitler. We've had them checked against pictures that we know from the Reich Archive that are of Adolf Hitler, and it isn't Hitler, it's Hitler's double.
Why Argentina? Of all the countries on the planet at that time in history, after the fall of Berlin, why Argentina? What's the significance of this country in terms of its relationship with Germany, Nazi Germany?
After the First World War, the Treaty of Versailles in 1918, Germany was pretty much stripped of all its colonial possessions around the world. So Tanganyika, German East Africa, Namibia, German Southwest Africa. The one thing they couldn't take away from Germany was the huge German colonies that had been established in Patagonia, both in Chilean Patagonia and in Argentine Patagonia, because they were in sovereign states. They weren't German colonies. They were large communities within Argentina and within Chile. Those communities grew enormously between the wars from 1918 until 1939. Argentina was the only country in the world which had its own Nazi party. There were 30,000 members of the Argentine Nazi Party who wore a swastika with a cogged wheel around it, who met in Luna Park, one of the big venues in Buenos Aires, in the late 30s to celebrate the Anschluss between Austria and Germany. And if you look at the pictures that were shot by the Americans at the time, it looks like a Nuremberg rally. Argentina had a large German pro-Nazi community embedded within it. We also know from very brave Argentine politicians at the time that Eva Perón, Eva Duarte as she was, and Juan Domingo Perón, who became the two most important people in Argentina post-war, were both in the pay of German military intelligence since 1941. We have the documents that prove this, which were found in Berlin post-war by this group of Argentine Democrats who had been fighting against what was a fascist dictatorship in Argentina. From 1943 onwards, billions were pumped into Argentina from Nazi Germany to establish this, I don't know what they were hoping for, a Fourth Reich in the sun or something. But it's interesting to know that when people think about Latin America, they think about jungles and the Mato Grosso and, you know, the Amazon, and it's not like that. Buenos Aires, for instance, is a very sophisticated European city, and much of Argentina is a lot like Europe. If you go down to San Carlos de Bariloche, which is where many of the Nazis went post-war, you have a place that looks like Bavaria, and not only looks like Bavaria, but German is for a second spoken language for almost everybody there.
Now, also, the area of Bariloche, some very wealthy Nazis from Europe owned large tracts of land down there, including, I'm told, Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands.
Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands' family has been in that area since, I don't know, the 1890s, the Schamburg-Lippe family. It was their family, his cousins, who were the senior Nazi diplomats in Chile. And Bariloche, the whole area of San Carlos, is just across the border from Chile. In the Andes along that range. The Estancia San Ramon, which is tens of thousands of hectares, it's huge, is the place where Hitler first went to. It was his first point of refuge in Argentina after he'd arrived on the coast. It's deep inland in an area that had been Germanic for, well, since the 1870s, 1880s. Prince Bernhard's family still own large tracts. Prince Bernhard's family, as in the Dutch royal family, still own large tracts of land themselves in Bariloche, never mind their cousins, the Schamburg-Lippes, who have since sold the San Ramon Estancia. But it's not just them. It was the various Gauleiters came out post-war. Lanchner was one of them. He had a huge construction business around Bariloche. Erich Priebke, the SS captain, who is now still under house arrest in Italy for his part in the Ardentine Caves massacre, where 340-ish Italian civilians were killed because of an attack on an SS convoy. There are Nazi after Nazi after Nazi who fled to Argentina post-war. Originally, we said about 30,000. That was our estimate. As we move further ahead with our research, and we're writing a second book, we're writing a sequel to Grey Wolf at the moment, which we hope will be published next year, it looks like up to 100,000, and this is almost an unbelievable number, Nazis of different forms. They could have been SS Ukrainians, they could have been Belgians, French, Dutch. We have to remember Danish. We have to remember that there were so many others who were actually fighting alongside the Nazis, the Germans in World War II. But they were allowed to flee, and they fled with the help of the International Committee of the Red Cross and the anti-Semitic Jewish haters that were its head, and with the help of Pius XII and the whole organization within the Catholic Church and the Vatican. This is something people don't want to hear of. People don't want to hear that the Catholic Church allowed almost 100,000 of the worst people that Europe has ever produced. Not just allowed, but helped. They helped them down through a whole range of monasteries and safe houses into Vatican City, where they were given documents to enable them to travel, originally to Argentina and then on to South America in further countries.
No, who would believe this, honestly? Before I read your book, it's shocking. You guys must have had your eyes open completely when you saw this and thought, wow.
I think shocking is the right word, but the information is there. The documents are there in all the archives. This isn't made up. This is a representation of material that was there at the time.
When we return, we find out yet another disturbing truth.
The American government gave them millions of dollars to say sorry that we bombed your Nazi war material producing factories that you were making a profit out of.
Martin Bormann arrived in Argentina in 1948. Pablo saw him at Inalco. Jorge Colotto met him in 1955 when Juan Domingo Perón greeted his long-term friend and paid his hotel bill in Buenos Aires. Araceli Mendez worked for him in Buenos Aires and spent almost 3 years rebuffing his advances. She kept pictures of him. The Argentine Federal Police kept a file on Bormann, much of which was burnt in the 1960s, but documents remain, which we have, and prove he and his lover Alicia Magnus stayed at the Plaza Hotel. At least 30,000 Nazis, Ustashi, Croatia's bloodthirsty animals led by Ante Pavelić, and other European fascists fled to South America after the war. They were helped by the Perons, the Catholic Church, the Red Cross, and KLM under Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands. Adolf Hitler, the worst and most evil criminal of the 20th century, often used the alias Mr. Wolf. The name Adolf comes from the High German for noble wolf. His first mistress called him Wolf, and it was as Herr Wolf that he was introduced to Eva Braun. Hitler's yacht was called the Sea Wolf, and his personal plane, the Flying Wolf. His field headquarters in East Prussia, the Ukraine, and France all had the word Wolf in the title.
Welcome back. We're here with the author of Grey Wolf, Mr. Gerrard Williams. Gerrard, the title of the book, Grey Wolf, how does this fit into the story?
Hitler used the pseudonym Mr. Wolf throughout his early political career. I think probably because the name Adolf is based on the old High German for noble wolf. That's where the name gets its derivative from. His headquarters throughout the war were known as the Wolf's Lair, the Wolf's Gorge. His plane was known as the Flying Wolf. Before the war, when he was introduced to Eva Braun for the first time in the photographer's studio where she worked, he was introduced as Mr. Wolf. Wolf was a big part of Adolf Hitler's strange personality. In fact, his sister, Paula Hitler, took the name Wolf herself during the war so that she could hide away from any reflected glory or whatever from her elder brother. Grey Wolf was a title which said that this was the wolf going grey. This was the wolf in exile. This was the wolf getting older. Of course, one of the most fearsome weapons of the Nazis during World War II were also the grey wolves, the submarine U-boat packs that ravaged Allied shipping in the Atlantic. And of course, it was one of those grey wolves in the final operation of the U-boats in World War II, which was known as Sea Wolf. That was its code name, that Adolf Hitler escaped via Fuerteventura to the coast of Argentina. So grey wolf was something that seemed to be, it's not a code name or anything like that, but it's just the wolf going grey. And that's where the name came from. It stuck. It became grey wolf.
Now, you showed me some clips from your documentary film. Fantastic film, by the way.
Thank you.
But one thing that really struck me in this film was it seemed that this one of the central characters, one of the big personalities, was Martin Bormann. So tell us a little about the significance of this man during the war and after.
I think Martin Bormann is one of those characters that for some reason has been sidelined by history. In various films you will see him as an ineffectual secretary. Die Untergang, Downfall, has him not as a central figure at all. He's been described by various intelligence agencies as the most dangerous man in Europe, a title that was occasionally given to Skorzeny, Hitler's favorite commando, but Bormann was the most dangerous man in Europe. Bormann was the complete power behind the Nazi throne. This guy was an economic and administrative genius who, when other more flamboyant figures in that sick regime, Goering or Goebbels or Himmler, were prancing around in their smart uniforms, designed by Hugo Boss most of the time, Goering and Martin Bormann was in the background. But it was Bormann who recognized the financial importance of not just Hitler, but the Nazi Party as a brand from very early on. He licensed Hitler's image, for instance, on every coin or every stamp, and made sure that Hitler got a portion of each sale that was made on that. I mean, it's the first example. We see it all the time now with everybody from David Beckham to Magic Johnson. I'm not comparing either of those two great guys to Adolf Hitler, but marketing a personality, marketing a brand. Martin Bormann knew all about that. Bormann also understood the real financial workings of Nazism. He'd been involved, along with his then boss, Rudolf Hess, in negotiations with American bankers and American industrialists in the 30s to finance the Nazi Party to the tune of, well, today it would be $1 billion. I think it was equivalent to the GDP of the US for 1 year in those days. So we're talking massive investment of capital and skills into Nazi Germany. Bormann isn't seen in history. I mean, there are very few pictures of Martin Bormann. You see him occasionally in group shots. Very few pictures of him. He wasn't somebody who wanted to make his presence widely known. And yet he was Secretary of the Chancellery. He was Secretary of the Nazi Party. Not a secretary. The Secretary of the Nazi Party, the biggest organization in Germany. Bormann also understood how economics and world banking operated. And we believe, and we have the information, I think, presented in Grey Wolf pretty solidly, that from 1943 onwards, he recognized that Nazi Germany was finished in one form or another. Militarily, they were going to get destroyed. This was after the defeat at Al Alamein in the desert by the British, and then Stalingrad happened, and then the Kursk tank battles, and it was pretty obvious that the whole empire was contracting and falling apart. Unless the wonder weapons turned up, if the Nazis had got the atomics first, maybe the world would have been a different place. But from 1943 on, Martin Bormann made a decision that the capital that the German people, the Nazis, had looted and raped from the rest of Europe would be sent overseas, along with the collusion of all the German companies that we know by name today, with all their patents and all their intelligence and all their information, so that no matter what happened to Nazi Germany, that Germany could once again become resurgent after World War II. The capital would go out, and we're talking shipments of gold and bullion, and yes, we're talking shipments of concentration camp gold. But what we're talking more about here is an international banking system that worked in exactly the same way as the banking system does today. You ask a counterparty in Switzerland to transfer $5 million to your bank account in Argentina. And it is done telegraphically. This doesn't have to be submarines full of gold. It doesn't have to be paintings and art objets and everything else going out. He knew how to telegraphically transfer the wealth of the Third Reich out to Argentina. Not just Argentina, Syria, Turkey, various other neutral countries at the time, who were more than willing to accept for a percentage. I think the Swiss got 6% on every transaction. Then the counterparty in Argentina would have probably got 3%. It's exactly the same way that things work today. Bormann knew it was all over, that there was never going to be an opportunity for Nazi Germany to win militarily. But he also knew that he could plan for the influence of Germany in a post-war Europe by moving all this material and wealth, I mean really significant country-buying wealth, out of Germany. And as I say, most of it went to Argentina. Some of it to Brazil as well, Paraguay and Chile, but most of it to Argentina.
I'm going to name you a few companies, and some people are going to find these names very familiar, even in today's industrial world. I've got IBM, ITT, Ford Motors, Chase Manhattan Bank.
Where would you like to start?
Mannesmann Bartelsmann, Siemens, Deutsche Bank. Did Bormann create a myriad of shell companies after the war or during the war?
Well, let's just take one major German company, ThyssenKrupp, the big steel company. From 1943 until the end of the war, they had created over 700 dummy corporations on their own outside of Nazi Germany within neutral countries. Siemens, which was named as basically an SS international operation by British intelligence in 1940 on. Siemens had offices all over the world. They were all staffed by senior Nazi members, senior party members. Siemens Argentina, for instance, was huge, and you know, was heavily involved in the industrial electrics side of things there. But Siemens effectively had a global operation that was bigger than German military intelligence overseas. And they were all loyal to the party, not to Germany, but to the party. Germany and the party are intermingled, but we have to remember that not every German was a Nazi. Far too many Germans were Nazis, but not every German was a Nazi, and not every German living overseas was a Nazi either. But companies like Siemens had links to all the major American corporations who had invested heavily in Nazi Germany from 1934, 1935 onwards. IBM, for instance, ran the Holocaust. They put in the counting machines that enabled them to process millions of Jews, gypsies, homosexuals, political people through the extermination camps. Now, you know, that was hidden for a very long time, but what has recently come out, nothing to do with our research, but better research, different research in America, shows that IBM actually had IBM employees at Auschwitz, at Buchenwald, at Ravensbrück, who were actually running these damned counting machines on the ground. It was being micromanaged by IBM out of New York. ITT, another great American company, owned 25% of Fokker Wolf, the fighter aircraft manufacturer. So American corporate money was paying to build fighters that were shooting down American boys in American bombers over German cities from 1943 onwards. I mean, I don't understand this. Henry Ford, the Ford Motor Company. It's a cuddly family American tradition. Henry Ford was the worst anti-Semite in history. His writings in the 20s and 30s had a direct influence on Hitler's Mein Kampf. He's a disgusting creature, Henry Ford. Just because he could give you any car you liked in any color you liked, as long as it was black, doesn't make him a good man. The Ford Motor Company produced over a third of all trucks used by the German army in World War II. Trucks that took German soldiers to fight Americans, Canadians, and British troops on the beaches in Normandy.
So let me get this straight. While the war was going on, while U.S. servicemen and British servicemen and Allied forces were fighting the Reich, American money was coming through places like the Union Bank of New York, the Harriman Brothers,
Manhattan,
Two Farben Corporation, and all these other companies like Ford. The same money was at the same time coming in as we're fighting the Germans.
Yeah, and profits are going back. So, you know, everybody's making money out of this. I mean, that's the disgusting thing. The most amazing thing for me is that we'll take just ITT and the Ford Motor Company at the time. And Ford will hide all this. They'll say, no, these were our German subsidiaries. We didn't have anything to do with it. Well, the documentation is coming out, I'm sorry, and we're finally knowing what the truth is. Their plants were also off the bombing lists we weren't allowed to bomb them during the war, despite the fact they're creating huge amounts of material for the Nazis' war effort. And at the end of World War II, a couple of American bomber groups made a mistake, saw them as targets of opportunity, and bombed both ITT and the Ford Motor Company plants. Well, ITT and Ford Motor Company took the American government to court after the war and got millions of dollars in reparations. The American government gave them millions of dollars to say sorry that we bombed your Nazi war material producing factories that you were making a profit out of. Well, you know, Hitler escaping to Argentina, shocking enough. When you find out that companies that are still around today, not just German companies, who have Hugo Boss, great example, designed all the SS uniforms. There's a Hugo Boss in every street corner of every major city now. Well, I don't know if that's right. I don't know how I feel about that. Do I feel good about a company that made its name and its fortune out of Nazi Germany still being able to make profits today? I don't know. Ask a corporate lawyer. But the same is true about IBM, ITT, Siemens, the Ford Motor Company. The list is virtually endless. It was all about making money. I mean, the sacrifices that my father's generation made, my dad was a combat soldier for 6 years and was wounded twice. The sacrifices his generation made seemed at the time to be a great crusade, a necessary crusade against the evils of this most pernicious, vicious, fascist system. And yet, at the same time, there were people making a load of money out of it.
Do you think this is one of the reasons why Hitler's escape to Argentina and all the top Nazis was kept a secret, because there was a vested interest post-World War II?
Completely vested interest. I think that we have Alan Dulles to thank in great part for this. Head of OSS CIA post-war, but also OSS station chief in Switzerland during the war. And we have information that Dulles had contacts with many high-level Nazis, including Bormann, throughout the end period of the war. They were negotiating all over the place. Now, interestingly enough, Dulles had been a corporate lawyer with his brother, John Foster Dulles, in Germany before the war had happened. He knew Martin Bormann. I'm not sure if he'd met Hitler, but he knew Bormann and he knew most of the people within the Chancellery, within the senior levels of the party. His contacts weren't the only ones. I mean, you go on with book two, deals with John J. McCloy a great deal. McCloy in 1950 was running West Germany for the American government, and he freed all the industrialists who'd been put away at Nuremberg. By 1952, there were no Nazis left in jail, effectively. None of the big Nazis. One of the major Nazi industrialists said at Nuremberg, "I don't care what you do, we've got so many friends in Washington, we'll be out soon." And they were. It's all about making money. It's one of the sickest parts of the untold story of World War II. And that collusion, that interlinking between American big business and aspects of the intelligence community enabled Hitler and Bormann and much of their wealth to leave. They knew where the bodies were buried. If they'd come out and named the Americans who were involved in this, I don't think that America, as a democratic nation, would have put up with it.
When we come back, the re-employment of thousands of ex-Nazi officers.
Post-war, Germany was run by people who had gone home, taken off their SS uniforms or their Nazi Party uniforms, had put on their Hugo Boss suits, and had gone back to work.
In July 1945, I was the housekeeper at the Estancia San Ramon. The whole house had been busy for days. Guests had already arrived from Cordoba and Buenos Aires, and we'd been told to expect more. The ranch was German-owned and had been the first settlement in the area. I'd worked there for about 10 years after my husband passed away. My sister also worked there. We had one of the only radios in the area capable of picking up news from Europe. The only railway line from the coast came into the property.
Carmen!
Bariloche, our nearest town, was about 25 kilometres away. The road was awful, but we were pretty self-sufficient on the ranch. I wasn't surprised when I heard the Hitlers were coming. No one thought much about it. Anyway, no one here believed the stories that he'd killed himself. The San Ramon Estancia belonged to the Prince of Schaumburg-Lippe, a Nazi sympathizer based in Argentina, part of the family of Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands, who was himself an SS officer. Bernhard was often in Bariloche after the war.
The last 12 months had taken its toll on his body, if not his spirit. Without the penicillin we got from Dulles, that bloody Stauffenberg bomb would have finished him off. No one knew just how many festering splinters had come out of the table, or how close he'd been to death. But here, enjoying his favorite foods and safe with family and friends, his health was improving.
We're back with investigative journalist and author, Mr. Gerrard Williams, who's uncovered one of the most amazing stories in living memory, Adolf Hitler escaping from the bunker and fleeing to Argentina after the Second World War. Now, Gerrard, one of the main things that struck me about this story was the almost this complete veil of secrecy at the time that was allowed to happen. Now, I know the Holocaust, the revelations of the Holocaust, they didn't come out until a few years after the Second World War. Do you think this was one of the keys, because it would have been incredibly embarrassing to have revealed Hitler's location, because the FBI knew about this. You've supplied us with a number of FBI documents with J. Edgar Hoover's signature on it, about Casino. We've got radiograms. We've got the Eichhorn's letters as well. Walk us through some of these documents.
I think the documents that we've been able to access are the tip of the iceberg, that there are many, many other documents there that have been stamped for a further 50 years, that the secrecy about this will continue on. It's interesting that Hoover didn't believe Hitler was dead, and he still had people looking for him, and he took every report seriously. And amongst those, something like 900 heavily redacted, which just means people have put their heavy liner through a lot of the information. Amongst the 900 reports that were issued, you get, I saw Hitler on a train in Chicago. And, you know, Hitler actually owns the farm next to me in Arizona. Well, they're silly. And they go along there with the Elvis sightings. But the documents that we've concentrated on in the book, these aren't the only evidence trail. The evidence trail is also from the witnesses, the eyewitnesses, the other information from reporters at the time. I think that not many people knew that Hitler had escaped and that Bormann had escaped. Trevor Roper, whose masterful work, The Last Days of Adolf Hitler, has become the accepted history. Trevor Roper was a medieval historian. Why did we put somebody like that in to do the detective work on the biggest death of the 20th century? I don't know. But there's a lot of information. The FBI reports, there's a CIA report that has been released. Can't get anything out of the British archives. I mean, everything is stamped for a further 50 years. I think that if the general public had known, remember Hitler was demonized throughout World War II by our own propaganda. Demonized for good reason. I mean, this man is an evil, horrible human being, but he's a swine. As are his senior cabinet members, and as are the people running the death camps in the East. People would have wondered what they'd fought the war for if they'd known that Hitler and Martin Bormann had escaped. And they'd been told that they'd fought the war to destroy this threat of fascism, this threat of Nazi Germany, this threat of, well, anti-Semitism in some ways, although we only knew about the real extent of the Holocaust, as you say. It's a story that's not even talked about much until 1948, 1949. And yet there are those pictures of American troops and British troops entering camps in early 1945 and then after the fall. The one thing that probably nailed any possibility that Nazi Germany could ever rise again, and I use the phrase Nazi Germany deliberately here, is that the swastika and the black boots and the red and black and the other symbolism that went along with that immensely powerful brand, I mean, we are talking an immensely powerful brand, that symbolism will forever be linked to the foul crimes these basically criminal gang of murdering thieves did in Europe, especially within Eastern Europe. So it could never come back. You could never have, I mean, nobody in their right mind, thank God neo-Nazis now who use the swastika as their symbol, right at the fringes of any political life anywhere in the world. It can't never come back. It's disgusting. It's a damaged brand forever. If people had known that the men behind that brand, two of the major men behind that brand, God knows how many SS generals and colonels and everything else, were allowed to escape and helped to escape, I don't know how the world would have reacted. In 1945, the people were tired. In May 1945, America and Britain still had Japan to deal with. And if it hadn't been for the atomics, we'd have fought a very bloody war to try and take the Japanese mainland. Well, that's what everybody suggests. 1945, everybody was tired, and Britain's industrial might was completely and totally spent. It needed to be over. It was very easy to use that suicide, that cowardly way out in Berlin, as the final point to that long sentence that had been World War II for so many people. But again, although this appears to have been hidden and appears to have been a conspiracy to cover it up, what has amazed me is that historians haven't gone back and looked at the information that was published at the time, that was available to them at the time.
We have news reports about Baumgart, the pilot flying him out. We have Time magazine at the time.
Time magazine that interview a major Ivan Nikitin of the Soviet intelligence, army Soviet intelligence, who describes in the chancellery, not in the bunker, but in the chancellery in Hitler's private quarters, a concrete door that slid away to lead down to a tunnel that was connected to the underground railway network in Berlin. And the door to that tunnel into the underground is still there, as far as I know. I'm pretty sure it is. He also said that they'd found a piece of paper which was partially charred on the floor of the intermediate bunker, which he was sure was from Eva Braun, which said to her parents what they could read was that she'd be away and wouldn't be in contact with them for some time. Well, okay, even if you're a historian, shouldn't you mention these facts next to the fact that Hitler had committed suicide in the bunker? People heard the shot. People didn't hear the shot. People saw the bodies. People didn't see the bodies. People were there when the bodies were burnt. People were there when the bodies were taken and buried in the chancellery gardens. But this isn't what the Russians find when they arrive. They find Magda Goebbels and Joseph Goebbels' partly burnt bodies. They've been burnt with petrol in the same way that Hitler and Eva Braun's bodies are supposedly incinerated with petrol. They find them, and they're recognizably Magda and Joseph Goebbels. They find the six bodies of the kids who they've murdered downstairs. And they bring them out and they lay them out and they show them. They don't find anything that could have been Hitler or Eva Braun. I don't understand why generations now, and it is generations of historians, have simply accepted Hugh Trevor Roper's report without suggesting that Stalin didn't believe it. Or Marshal Zhukov, the commanding general in the area, didn't believe it. The people who Trevor Roper said he interviewed, one of them, who was the Luftwaffe, the Air Force attaché in the bunker, said after the war that he always laughed whenever he read The Last Days of Hitler, because Trevor Roper just produced the lies he told him.
One man's version of history, which is the version of history that certain people at the time liked to have in place.
Wanted to have in place. It's a little bit like Martin Bormann dying in Berlin. Again, this is something that has been brought up and fabricated again and again and again.
It's the official narrative. It gives closure to all these names and all these characters.
And people will say that that official narrative was given closure in Bormann's case because DNA testing was done in the 90s on the remains that they'd found after not having found them four times before in exactly the same place. And that DNA testing proved that the body they found was Martin Bormann. Well, great, except the West German government tested against an 83-year-old relative of Martin Bormann, who they refused to name. Bormann had, what, 9 children, most of whom survived World War II? His son wouldn't accept the ashes or anything like that, because he said, how could I be convinced it's my father? We don't know anything about an 83-year-old relative. What we have to remember is that post-war, Germany was run by people who had gone home, taken off their SS uniforms or their Nazi party uniforms, had put on their Hugo Boss suits, and had gone back to work. Denazification in Germany post-war is a myth.
BND, German intelligence.
Ah, German intelligence based completely.
How much Nazi pedigree is in the West German intelligence apparatus after the war?
It started with the Galen organization, the general who'd been in charge of intelligence gathering on the Eastern Front against the Russians. It was a huge coup for America and for Britain to have all this information about the Russians, who had suddenly become the real threat. Well, Germany was dead, you know, nailed Nazis. So now it was, we needed a red threat. Somebody needed a red threat anyway. The Galen organization helped to create that red threat paranoia by passing over information that they had gathered on Russian involvement when they'd been fighting them. Galen also had a few names of quite senior American officials who were Soviet agents, which helped him smooth his path into it. His organization, which I think eventually extended something like 30,000 men, was known as the Gestapo Boys by British intelligence, because every single one of those officers had been either SS or Gestapo or Wehrmacht during World War II. They were all members of the Nazi Party, to a man. So that's the formation of the West German intelligence organization, the BND as it became known. It's interesting to note as well that the BND's employment policy is to give favoritism to the sons and daughters of operatives who've already served in the BND. So the second generation of West German intelligence were the sons and daughters of committed Nazis.
Do you think it's possible the Gestapo or remnants of the Gestapo are still active in Patagonia?
I think that there is a grown-up corporate organization that manages what is still one of the largest fortunes in existence. You know, people don't wander around wearing armbands, and they just don't. We've had people threatened, we've had witnesses threatened in Argentina. I think that a lot of the money is back in Europe, or back in Wall Street, or back in London, and hopefully they've lost a lot of it in the last 4 years, because God knows everybody else has, apart from Bob Dimon and a few others. But I think that there is still a security organization that monitors people asking too many questions. They haven't come after me. They haven't come after Simon. But maybe we're not a threat. It doesn't really matter. You know, people will take this as another conspiracy theory. Bilderberg, Illuminati, aliens, reptiles, whatever. Dump us in with that lot. That way the real story won't be looked at. That way the information that we've brought out won't be examined properly. Make this a conspiracy theory. It'll go away. Well, Patrick, I'm sorry, it's not going to go away. The second book shows more information that was gathered at the time and goes into much further detail on the economic and financial implications of what happened at the end of World War II.
And you touch on Bilderberg in your next book.
Bilderberg's an important organization. It isn't a conspiracy theory either.
It's real.
But it's lumped in with the Illuminati and the reptiles.
It's very real.
The alien bases and all the rest of it. I haven't looked at it in detail. I fully intend to look at it in further detail, mainly because it was founded by Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands. And once an SS Nazi officer, always an SS Nazi officer.
Well, the book is The Grey Wolf. I've seen a few clips of your film. It's absolutely brilliant. And we look forward to seeing this film in the very near future. And I would like to thank our guest, Gerrard Williams, who's the author of this fantastic book, one of the most fascinating reads you'll have come across in the last few years. I'd like to thank you very much for joining us. So there you have it. Adolf Hitler and his wife Eva Braun and countless other high-ranking Nazis all spirited away to Argentina after the war, and it was covered up by our own governments. But you have to ask yourself, if history was wrong about one of the most significant events of the 20th century, what else have we been lied to about? I'm Patrick Henningsen for the 21st Century Wire.